Hi, welcome to Mature Matters, a show brought to you in cooperation with the City of Farmington Hills and the Farmington Area Commission on Aging. My name is Lou Cantor, and I have two guests with me today. One is Natalie Pierce with the Area Agency on Aging 1B, and the other is Paula Zimmer with the Lakeshore Legal Aid Group.
Right.
And we're really happy to have both of you here today, because we're going to be talking about a really important subject to all of us, which is elder abuse. But first, I'd like to let you know a little bit about the backgrounds of our guests. And therefore, Natalie, why don't you tell me, please, how you got into this business in the first place?
Thank you, Lou. I have a grandmother who has since been deceased, but suffered from Alzheimer's dementia. And I watched that process, and it gave me a sense of wanting to work with older adults and prevent some things that happened to her along the way. And also, I have a social work background, and so I progressed into this slowly throughout my career.
Wonderful. You came into this with a real passion then.
Yes.
It's not just a job to you.
Correct.
Right. Yeah. Wonderful. And Paula?
Well, I am passionate. I'm a lawyer.
Uh-huh.
And years ago, a nun sent me to law school. And I made a promise that I would represent poor people, and I've been happy to do that for 35 years. So about 8 years ago, I started representing seniors more commonly, because before that was mostly involved in family law.
Mm-hmm.
But I really love the work with seniors, and I was telling Natalie, I've been out here in Farmington, it seemed to me, three times the last month or so with Bar Association, and I love the community.
Now, part of Lakeshore Legal Aid is one of the unique aspects of your job and maybe your organization is that you represent people that don't have to pay you a fee.
No, they do not pay a thing. They cannot pay. We are funded by Area Agency on Aging, among other things, but the Michigan Bar Foundation supports us, the Oakland County Bar, United Way. My boss is great at getting together grants so that we can represent people, and we do not ask a fee. At all, we cannot take a fee. Now, there are other lawyers who represent people. Lawyers work with us in a pro bono capacity. So there are a lot of things available for seniors in Oakland, for people who are over 60 years old.
So if you, the audience, hear of something that is of concern to you today and you feel like there might be a need for some sort of legal advice, we'll have a phone number. A couple of phone numbers up for you, so you might even want to get a pencil out to keep track of some of these, because you'll hear some important information and some phone numbers to refer to. But to get to the subject, let's talk specifically about elder abuse. And probably be a good idea, Natalie, to start with a definition of what elder abuse is all about.
Sure. To begin, there are three major rubrics, categories of elder abuse. One is abuse, one is neglect, and one is exploitation. Under the abuse category, we have physical abuse or the threat of physical abuse. We have emotional abuse, verbal attacks, rejecting the person, putting the person down, isolating the person. And then we also have sexual abuse, which is all degrees of sexual abuse, criminal sexual conduct against an older adult. Then we have the neglect piece, which comes in both the self-neglect form and the neglect of a caregiver who is charged with caregiving for that elder. And the neglect could be in the form of not giving the person their medications, stealing their medications, depriving them of food and water.
So all sorts of things to be aware of out there.
And sometimes in the neglect piece particularly, I think people don't intend it the way they do with other things that are criminal in intent. But you know, I don't know how to handle this situation. I don't know what Alzheimer's is all about. I don't know how it manifests itself. If I just, you know, lock her up somewhere, things will get better.
Mm-hmm.
Things will get better for me, for sure. It's a very sad thing. People need supports.
Support groups are probably really important in this group of dealing with elders for especially people who are family members who are not trained, don't have a geriatric degree or one thing or another. They're just all of a sudden thrust into the situation, and they, my goodness, they woke up one morning and they find out that their spouse, whether female or male, their spouse is not capacity, doesn't have the capacity to be the same person that they were and have to be quote unquote taken care of when she or he is already, all my life, 50 years, we've been married, she or he has been cooking my dinner and doing these sorts of things, cleaning the house, and all of a sudden, not doing that anymore.
Right, and that's why we have support programs for caregivers of older adults with Alzheimer's dementia via our agency, which are available throughout Oakland County as well.
Mm-hmm. And you know, there's respite too for people, because sometimes they need somebody to come in and take care of this person in their home who needs care, so they can get out and get to those meetings and get a little bit of support.
Right. I know Farmington Hills, the city at the Kostick Center, has a respite program, respite program for that sort of a situation, and it gives the caregiver a great deal of freedom to go out and do the things that they've been able to do or want to do.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. So let's talk about the individual situations that we have to be aware of, and that's the purpose of our meeting today, is to really raise the awareness factor here. There's physical that you mentioned, and that's generally pretty easy for an outsider to see, and it's also pretty easy in general for the person who is being abused, you know, to say, wait a minute, there's an issue here.
No, I'm going to interrupt you, because I would say not so. I remember when I first came into this work, I listened to the story of a police officer whose father was being abused and he didn't know. It didn't occur to him, when his father had long sleeve shirts on in the summer, that maybe those long sleeves were hiding something. His father didn't want to complain to him, and so he didn't, but he should have noticed. And today he feels very guilty that he never noticed all kinds of different red flags. For instance, the brother who took care of the father would never let anybody just show up. They always had to call and announce that they were coming over. That's a serious red flag for people.
Interesting.
That they don't always recognize. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, and I think also there's a point of shame that comes along with knowing that your family member, your spouse, your child is physically abusing or neglecting you or stealing your money. Mm-hmm. It's very hard for people to admit, particularly generationally speaking. Different generations have different communication styles, and particularly for the older generation, it's difficult to name something that's happening in the home, because typically there's the philosophy of not airing the dirty laundry.
Right. So that's good. That's good to know. So it could indeed be going on, and maybe it should be obvious, but for those of us who don't know, again, the reason for us to be here today is to find out these things.
Right.
Okay. So we have the physical aspect of it. Mm-hmm. And the physical aspect can, as we've said, entail more than a beating or something like that. Mm-hmm. It can be withholding things.
Yeah, frequently is withholding and not taking care of business. Elders have to get out to appointments. They have to be taken somewhere sometimes. Mm-hmm. And to just neglect those appointments and not take somebody else, or to be very interested in taking them to the bank, so that we get grandma dressed up and off she goes to the bank to take $500 out of her account. That I'm quite interested in doing. And we're hoping Natalie will talk to us later, I think, about some bills pending in the Michigan legislature. But we really know that the banks are interested in being part of the solution here. But we all have to be aware about it.
Right. Awareness is the key.
Right.
Yeah. The other aspect is the mental side of it. Can you get into that a little bit from that aspect versus the physical?
Mm-hmm. That would be name calling. That would be intimidating a person, yelling, any sort of emotional
demeaning
put downs, and that can also include with the neglect piece and all of this emotional. Mental piece is also the spiritual piece, and that can be denying someone the right to their own spirituality and faith. We don't get into that a lot in this area, but it is an aspect of it that is important to a lot of older adults.
Mm-hmm. If you know the elder person would like to go to church, has gone to church all their lives, and now all of a sudden they're dependent upon you, and you don't you know, go out of your way, in essence, to take them to church, even though they might not be saying anything about it. It's kind of that withholding aspect.
Sure, and that can be an isolation tactic as well.
Mm-hmm. Sure, and you know, even if it's difficult to take elders places, so maybe you can't take them to church, but you can call the church where they've attended for years and say to the pastor, "She's not able to come out. Can somebody come?" Mm-hmm. Those visits are wonderful. Mm-hmm. They are very uplifting, and it's the kind of thing that churches are normally intent on doing, so they want to do it.
You bet.
And that's why it's important to have our faith-based partners involved with this as well.
And that's what you're doing is in part of Area Agency on Aging 1B, is that you're doing the outreach to get these organizations involved.
Yes, we're doing that in partnership with Paula's organization, Lakeshore Legal Aid, as well as a number of organizations throughout Oakland County. Mm-hmm.
Let me talk to you, and I can, about a group that we do have in Oakland County. It was founded by Lynn Alexander, who has been interested in elder issues forever, and Judge Ed Sosnick. And it's a group of professionals. This is everything from law enforcement to the prosecutor's office to the courts to first responders to home health organizations, banks. I am an attorney who does civil legal services, and we all meet together to talk about what we can do to raise awareness, to educate the professionals and the community about elder abuse situations, to try and come up with some good protocols that can be used across the board so you're not doing this alone. You can't do it alone. And so our being able to come together, we meet normally once a month, and it's a very big help to somebody like me. And then Natalie and I belong to one that's Oakland and Wayne together, a community response team that is the same kind of thing, but that one's across county lines, which is different.
So what you're doing is you're meeting, having brainstorming sessions,
right,
and figuring out ways to make the public more aware and solve some of the problems that come up along the way.
Absolutely, and in fact, SAVE Oakland is going to have a symposium on April 27th, which is a Friday, from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m., and it's designed for professionals, I believe. Please correct me if I'm wrong. And we will be having Carrie Cederberg, who is the Director of Office of Services to the Aging currently at the state level, as one of our keynote speakers.
Great.
That's true.
And in making people aware, one of the backstops that we've tried to bring into this are the banks,
yes,
making the banking personnel aware of what's going on, looking for red flags.
Right.
And there, I understand there are a few red flags.
There are. It is really interesting because the banks are cautious because people have rights. Somebody has a right to put their money in a bank and to take it out. What they want to interrupt if they can is somebody who's doing that against their will, or somebody who doesn't have capacity to do their own banking any longer is taking out money and giving it to somebody. Very frequently a caregiver who's maybe a company caregiver or a family member who's ripping them off. And we find that when a bank teller can recognize this kind of thing and question it, very often the people who are trying these scams, they know they're hanging out there, and so a little spotlight on it causes them to interrupt that process and they stop it. So the banks are now working with the Michigan legislature to try and come up with something that we can all live with, mm-hmm, that protects the individual who has a right to their money, but also makes sure to protect them from scammers.
Mm-hmm. Another thing is that I know seniors have been brought up in quote unquote a different era, mm-hmm, and an era when there was a lot more trust. And that trust went in when somebody made a phone call to you, you know, and asked you questions as a senior. It was kind of the normal thing for you to trust that person, mm-hmm, who was asking you. They may come across with a voice of authority or something along those lines. They ask for a social security number, or they ask for something else that's private information that is just walking them down the road, basically, to have their identity stolen.
Mm-hmm.
And so these scams, it's a matter of making people aware, the seniors themselves aware that, you know, we are in a different era now.
Mm-hmm.
and we can't be as trustful as we used to be.
I'm really glad you said that, because I think seniors, first of all, they always want to answer the telephone.
You bet.
So they hurry to get to the telephone, get there, and this nice person on the other end of the line, when you want that kind of information, you're not nasty.
No.
So you want that information, you're really just sweet, and you ask those questions, and so often that information is given out.
I have to remind people that these scammers that are out there on the phone, on the other end of the phone, making the phone call, they practice.
Oh, yeah.
They know exactly, you know, they're just like the good guys are practicing, the bad guys are practicing too. And they're out there practicing, well, what do we say if she says this? How do we make the tone of our voice right? You know, how do we ask the question that elicits the social number, social security number, or elicits the bank account number? Do we tell her, how do we get the name of her grandchild, you know, from her, and tell her that grandchild is in an accident and needs help, and we need a credit card?
And you know, when you hear these stories, they sound incredible to us. But recently I had a great experience with a church in Royal Oak, where with a very sophisticated group of seniors, and we talked about these things, and we smiled about that grandparent phone call in the middle of the night kind of situation. One gentleman came up to me after, and he said, I lost $5,000 through one of those. And I said, you? Because he seemed sophisticated. He said, I wanted to help my grandson no matter what. I was so afraid. I wanted $5,000. I thought, oh, how sad.
I have a very savvy friend who got caught up in that. And I thought, you did what? and it happens. Mm-hmm. The pressure of the moment.
Right.
You're caught 5 o'clock in the morning, even 2 o'clock in the afternoon. It doesn't matter.
Sure.
You get that phone call. Our point is, don't be trusting when you get that phone call unless you know the person on the other end, unless you know that you know the person on the other end of the phone.
That's true. And the other thing that we always say, I know I've heard Natalie say this, is if you've made the phone call to somebody and you've called the bank, you've called whatever it is, and sometimes they ask you for something, you can be cautious but give information. But when someone has called you, you have no idea who's on the other end of that line.
Right. And there's nothing wrong with you saying, let me get your phone number and call you back.
That's true.
And so there's ways to prevent it. But the point is to stay away from the emotional, oh my God, type of a thing.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's talk a little bit about what's being done other than awareness, which awareness is very important. I know the city of Farmington Hills puts on seminars on a regular basis. We have the respite program to give the caregivers space and time.
Mm-hmm.
What about legislation that's coming down the pike?
Absolutely. There's a bill package that has been in committee, came from the Senate to the House.
Yep.
And one of the areas it does address is a financial exploitation, stiffening penalties for perpetrators of this kind of crime. Also, asking banks to step up and train their staff on the signs of these types of crimes, the exploitation, and ask them to learn how to spot the red flags and then what to do when they see the red flags. It is not to be confused with requiring by law banking institutions to become mandatory reporters. That is not the case. It's more of a training and awareness building.
And what is area agency's role in this?
Well, we have, I would say, multiple roles in this. One of the areas that we fund is elder abuse prevention, awareness, and exploitation. And Paula Lakeshore Legal Aid is one of our partners in that. We also, I specialize in elder abuse, neglect, and exploitation, the prevention and awareness building. So I serve on committees in all six county region that we serve surrounding Wayne County.
Do you lobby in Lansing?
I have a partner Paula has done some advocacy in that area, and also I have a partner who's an advocacy specialist, Ann Langford, at my organization, who does go directly to the committee meetings and testifies.
Okay, good. We were talking before the show about the need for new laws and whether or not there is a strong need for new laws, or is it more a matter of just enforcing the laws that are on the books and making people aware that there are laws out there that can be used?
Well, when I've testified, one of the things I've said, no, probably half the bills have what I call enhanced penalties. And that's fine. I mean, I don't want to say uninterested. I'm less interested in that kind of thing than the awareness and a registry of elder abusers and those kind of things that I think are better. It's hard for me to be sympathetic with anybody who does abuse, but enhanced penalties on the spectrum of remedies seem far down the line to me. I'm much more interested in things about awareness and making certain that seniors have the kind of supports they need.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When you say a registry, what is that? Is that something that people would go online to find out if there is somebody in the neighborhood?
Well, not only neighborhood, I don't think we're so worried about somebody who's abusing who lives in the neighborhood. We do that, for instance, on the sex register, of course.
That's what I was thinking.
But this one is, I mean, families hire caregivers. Mm-hmm. They hire somebody to take care of my mother 5 hours a day or whatever. And they have no idea when they hire somebody. You can hire individuals, you can hire a company. It's very hard for families to vet that kind of information. And a registry of known elder or adult abusers, just mm-hmm. abusers, mm-hmm. would be very helpful to families.
Okay, so we don't have something like that now.
We do not.
Okay.
But they've talked about doing it, and I think it's always hard to start up something like that. It takes time and effort, somebody who's good at that kind of thing. And but if you don't have the law, it's never going to happen.
Right. Okay, so that is important to
I think
be able
so.
Get something like that operational.
Right. And on the national level, there's conversations about that as well.
Mm-hmm. How does Michigan stand compared to other states in some of this prevention? And
frankly, we're a bit behind a lot of other states. We define adult abuse as being vulnerable adults, which means anybody over the age of 18 who is vulnerable in some area.
Mm-hmm.
We don't specify elders. A lot of states do. Mm-hmm. That makes it one challenge. I think Paula can speak to some others.
Hmm.
What I'm wondering is if we've got something that helps people from 18 on,
right?
That's all inclusive. Mm-hmm. So
right.
That would include, you know, elders also.
Right,
I mean,
it does.
We are speaking specifically of elder abuse, but we don't want anybody to be abused.
No.
So let's make everybody aware of it. I mean, if you have some sort of a disability and you're being abused, we need to be aware of it.
We do need to be aware of it.
Maybe it's to a certain extent is take the stigma. You mentioned the stigma of embarrassment and that sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
Away from it, so somebody, either a family member or the person who's being abused, can raise their hand without causing undue alarm and embarrassing repercussions.
Absolutely. I think that's a very important point. And again, we were discussing before the show that elder abuse is kind of where domestic violence was some years ago. It wasn't on the radar and the map as much. It wasn't regarded as much as a crime. And we're emerging into that period where we're starting to open up and recognize these crimes.
Okay. Okay. So what you've got several organizations, CCRC, which is Coordinating Community Response Coalition.
Correct.
We need to wrap up pretty soon here, so let's talk about some of these organizations that are out there that we can become aware of. The community response, that's a council of service providers?
Yes.
Then we've got Adult Protective Services.
Adult Protective Services has undergone a major change, and they have now a statewide number that is answered 24 hours a day. And it used to be that Children Protective Services kind of covered on the weekends.
Mm-hmm.
That is not true any longer. Adult Protective Services has a statewide number that is answered 24 hours a day. And so people should be able to call that if they're concerned about anything. I mean,
right.
Lou, we're gonna find that seniors themselves rarely make those phone calls. I mean, everything Natalie said about shaming and access to even telephone or whatever is hard. I wish they would call and report that something's happening that's not good and let it be looked into. Adult Protective Services has to begin an investigation within 24 hours. They have to have somebody come out and begin to look at.
They are mandated to get somebody involved, a person.
And what's interesting about that is, and I found this in my legal work, I generally do legal work in my office, but if I actually go out to somebody's house, there is so much that you can see.
There are signals
right
all over the place.
Away,
right.
If you're the least bit interested in using your eyes and ears, there's so much you can see. So Adult Protective Services, great.
Phone numbers. Adult Protective Services, and we'll put these on the screen, is 855-444-3911. That's for Adult Protective Services.
Correct.
Area Agency on Aging 1B is an information and referral for senior services, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that is an 800 number, 800-852-7795. And your Lakeshore Legal Aid Society?
Just Lakeshore Legal Aid.
Yeah. Is an 888-783-8190. And again, we mentioned at the beginning of the show that if you have an issue that comes up and you think you need legal aid, but you don't want to pay for it, you can't pay for it.
You can't pay
don't
us.
Don't worry. There's help out there.
Right.
Okay. Well, I think the important thing is awareness, knowing that there's a road to follow if you do see something, going out and making more people aware of what potentially is going on, and then solutions if there is an issue. And we've covered all of those things, and I'm really, really pleased that you two have been with us today.
Thank you.
And appreciate your time. And if any questions come up, there are some phone numbers for you all to review. And again, thanks for being here.
Thank you.
You're very welcome. Thank you for asking us.
Yeah.